So, hello everybody, and welcome to the OpenGL Beginners Workshop. And we are doing an introduction today to OpenGL. A very basic introduction. We are somehow even using the old approach, but even for those of you who have never worked with OpenGL before, you should get a chance today to get into it. And this is why we're doing it step by step, very slowly, very small steps. But I just want to make sure you get the point what we're doing here. So just a few words about me. My name is Kai Niklas. I'm CEO of the Decode GmbH in Germany. We are a German-Romanian company. And I'm an OpenGL trainer and developer for many years. And as OpenGL is my passion, I just like to give you the chance to get into it as well. I've just listed some links here for you that you may check. Of course, the page of my blog, where I also provide the OpenGL and Vulkan podcast. And the page of me being an OpenGL trainer and the page of our company itself. I can't tell you right now how long this workshop will take us, because I've never done it like this before. So we just start, and of course it depends as well on the questions that you have. Once more, you should be logged in on the Twitch account, and someone is saying hello there, hello, yes. And you should be logged in, if you want to our Skype group, our OpenGL Skype group. Both links are available on the pages that I sent to you. That's opengl2go.net/workshop.php. There you find all the links that we will need for this one here. So let's get started. First thing we need to do is to get a proper EDE set up, so an integrated develop environment, something there where we can code in. For this session, I've chosen CodeBlocks because it's a free one, a simple one to use. Of course, if you have another integrated develop environment and you know how to use it properly, and you maybe even spend some time setting up a free glut on it, then you're fine as well. But I will go through it step by step now using CodeBlocks and free glut to show you how to set it up properly, and hopefully this will work for you as well. I'm doing this now on a Windows environment. If you're on a Linux or a Mac, you should have taken a look before how to do it. If you haven't solved this problem right now, maybe after the workshop, stay online and we may just discuss in the chats how to get it on your system up and running. So first of all, make sure you have downloaded CodeBlocks and CodeBlocks and the free glut from the links that I showed you on the website. The free glut are compiled binaries for Windows already, although the header files should be fine for you as well. So this is what you should get. These two files here should be somewhere in your download folder. And if you don't have them by now, I just give you a minute to download them, so we all have the same data here. So I just post the link to the website once more in the chat, and you should just download those one here. I'll give you a minute to do this. okay, even with slow bandwidths, you should be fine till now, having downloaded the two of them. First of all, of course, you need to install the CodeBlocks API. The CodeBlocks EDE, the system in which we will be coding. So that's just regular install. I guess you should know how to handle an installation. So it's just a regular process. Quite important that you just leave all the passes as default. That would be great. And you just check all the things here to be installed. Leave the default pass, that makes it easier for you, and then just hit install. I've done it already on my machine, so I won't do it again right now, but this is just what you should do. It should just take 30 seconds, maybe a minute, to copy all the files to the proper directory and make the installation. And this is what you should do right now. I'm just giving you another few seconds here, checking the chat. Indeed, if you're wondering why I'm always looking to the left side, so I've got just another screen here where I got all the chats going on from you, so I stay up to date with what you are writing to me. So don't get irritated, I need to check all the time what's going on over there. But the installation should be running on your side right now. Just a few more moments so each of you has it set up properly. The proof that you have it set up properly will be that you have in your programs folder, like this one, you have a folder called CodeBlocks. This is what you should have when your installation is done. So, hopefully I'm not going too fast, but we are going on right now. Now we've got CodeBlocks installed on the system, which is the first step. But as we want to use OpenGL, we need some kind of help library, let's say. And this one is called FreeGLUT. That's a sequel to an older library that was existing called GLUT, which is just providing some functions for us to use OpenGL right away and not to handle all the nasty stuff, creating a window, managing all this stuff. So it just eases things very much for us. And we could do it without. But this would just mean we need to code hundreds of lines just to get a proper window. And that's not what we want to do today. We want to get started. We want to do OpenGL. So we are using this FreeGLUT library. So how do we install it properly? The first step should be you've got this zip here. You unzip it where you are and you just go to the folder and you should find in it three folders called bin, include, and lib. And we need to copy these folders somewhere into the CodeBlocks folder. So in CodeBlocks, you've got a folder called min-gw. And you see that you've got there some kind of folders like this as well. So this is fairly simple. We really just take the three folders from the FreeGLUT extracted folder and just copy them over here. And yes, I agree to overwrite everything that was there before. So really just copy the folders from here to here. Once again, we are in CodeBlocks, min-gw, and there we need to place the files. You should see this, that you have these folders already here. We need to copy the FreeGLUT files to the CodeBlocks. I'm just answering. So, you should have sound now again. Just give me a okay, it just stopped from changing FreeGLUT to GLUT. This is what you said. So, I'm going back to the folder where we, okay, sounds okay now, where we changed this. You may realize we have quite a delay of 5 seconds or something in the video. That's just the transmission. So we are going back here. So at this point, I forgot about it. If you open these files with your editor, you need, first of all, need to editor, open your editor as an administrator. So it's open Notepad++ or Notepad as administrator from your default Windows, and then open this file. So it will be... Yes. I now have opened my editor as admin, and now I can open the file. So you see I'm already there. Need to switch to all files, open the wizard script, and here we are again. So when you've done this, you search for GLUT32. This is what you need to do. I have already changed this, so it's free GLUT on my side. And you should find two occasions where you can replace this one. So it must be free GLUT here. And you will find another position, replace both appearance of GLUT32 to free GLUT, and you should be fine. And then when you've opened the editor as admin, you should be able to save this without the program telling you that you're not allowed to. So after this one, save it, close it. So we've modified the first file. And we need to change one more file to get it running in code blocks. So we go back to the code blocks program folder. And now we need to take another pass. It's share code blocks templates. This is where we need to go. You see it here on the left side. It's in the folder code blocks share templates. Code blocks share code blocks templates. I'm sorry. Here we need to search for another file called glutcbp. Try to find this file. And you need to open this one again, of course, as admin. So you should open your editor as an administrator and be able to edit the file. So again, you search for GLUT32 here, and you will find it in this position. I replaced it again, and you need to replace it as well with the word free GLUT. This is what you need to do. So changing this one here from GLUT32, this is what you should have there, to free GLUT, and we should be fine. You should just save this one. Once more, here's a path, that's the file, change GLUT32 to free GLUT, that's all we need to do in this file. And once you've saved this file, save, you're fine here as well. I don't save it on this side because I already have it done. So this should be it for setting up free GLUT with code blocks. Till now we should be fine, so we don't need this Windows any longer. Now you should have somewhere your code blocks program, rather on the desktop, or you just open it from the start menu. So let's run code blocks here. But let me just give each of you a second to reply to me in the chat if you had any problems so far setting up the files and making the changes to it. So just a second for you to reply to me on the chats. Okay, seem to be too fast here, so I'm just opening the folders again. Let me open the folders again. In the second file, once more, this is this one here, in code blocks, share code blocks templates, blood CBP. Opening it. You need to change this line here. This one should say at your place glut 32, and you need to change it to free glut. And the other question is, the other question was, someone is using OS X here, how this is working. As I said, I'm just doing this now on a Windows machine. Some of the stuff will be similar on a different system. Please follow anyway, and after the workshop, or maybe in one of the breaks, I guess even after the workshop, we will find the time to get it running on your system as well. So you could code along. Maybe it will not build and run on your machine right away, but just you may code with us. And in the end, we just need to make some minor changes on your system and it will all be running. So that's not a reason not to follow us here. Okay, one more thing that we need to do. I'm sorry, I forgot this as well. You realize I'm very prepared today. We need to once more go to the folder where we unzip the freeglut data. And of course, this now is very Windows specific. On different systems, it will be a bit different. There is a freeglut bin folder, which holds a freeglut.dll file. You should find this one in the extracted folder. And we should copy this one, copy the freeglut.dll, and just go to our Windows folder, because this is something the system needs to know. So we just need to place this somewhere. We paste it just into our Windows folder. So copying this freeglut.dll to the Windows folder, this will allow the freeglut application in the end to run on our system. So there it is. Once more, copying this one from the freeglut extracted folder to your Windows folder. That should be it. So, but after we've done this one, we are fine to launch code blocks and to start our first project there. Let me just check the chats. Everybody seems fine so far. So we can really go ahead and start our first project here. So what we need to do now is file, or we could just do it from here. Here's just a create new project link in the code block section. So we just tap this one. And it will ask us what kind of project we want to create here. So we want to create a glut project. This is why we did this changes for in the files, that we can use this one here properly. So just select the glut project here. Tell him, okay, this is what I want to use. And now he will ask us for the settings for the project. So we need to tell him how our project should be named. Let's call it test app or whatever you like, and tell him where he should store this project on your hard drive. So you just need to select some location on your system to tell him where to store it. Okay, so we need to go on, and now we need to tell him where are the glut files located to build the project. So you need to open, if this pass may be correct the first time, but to make sure, open it up, go to the programs folder. Oh, sometimes the first time when you push this button, another dialogue appears. But in this dialogue, you can just cancel this one, and then it will show you the folder browser here. Go to programs, go to code blocks, and select this min.gw folder, because this is where the includes and the libraries are. So this needs to be the folder you select. If you store it on a different path on your system, of course it's a different one, but in default setup it should be something like this. So when you've selected this one properly, you could go to next. On this page, that's just the compiler settings. We will leave everything as it is, because this should be fine in the default setting. Just make sure you've got this compiler here selected as well, so we all use the same system. Okay, and then we press finish, and then nothing changes here, but on the left side here in the project tab, we can fold out and we will see a main CPP file. And if we double click this one, we'll see a lot of code already. This is where we want to be, because we want to code today. So, to make sure the settings are fine so far, you can click the rebuild or just build and run button up here. The small green play button with a symbol behind it. And if we set up everything correctly, you should get something like this. So got a black background box here, but this is what you should get. This is what we want to do today. If you got any build errors, this will appear here in the log. Of course, we can't now take time for everybody to check his settings. We could do this after the workshop, so please be so kind just to follow us along. But hopefully it's working for the most of you. So this is just a demo file from the code blocks showing you that OpenGL is running properly on your machine. And we will start now from scratch to do our own OpenGL scene. And I will explain step by step what we want to do today. As you realize already by now, this is really a workshop. So we are not going through much theory, but we are going into detail, we are going to code. And I just see Danielle in the chat tells us all it's running fine on his machine. Thank you for this one. So we are going into the code, we are coding right away. And if you see this one here, your setup first of all is fine. If it's not, don't get too desperate. Just follow us along, because the code will be the same. It's just a minor changing in your system in the end to get it running as well. Okay, let's get into the code. We've got a lot of comments here. Of course, nobody is interested in these comments. And we've got a bunch of data here, but we're not going through this. We are building up our own system. So we are just going to delete pretty much everything here. We will really start from scratch. And this is what we will do now. So first of all, let me just check the chat once more, just a second. Okay, one question here is if we could use Visual Studio. Of course, you can use Visual Studio along. The settings there are quite the same. Indeed, you just need to copy the include and library files that we had to the proper folders of Visual Studio. Let me just show for the Visual Studio user where you need to place this data. Just a very quick one, because it's just fair for someone to follow us along. For Visual Studio, you will have in the program folder as well a Visual Studio folder. Now I need to check which one is mine. Yes, you need to find the proper version here. It's a bit confusing with the Visual Studio versions. And there you've got a VC folder. So programs, Visual Studio, VC. And you see again here I include in library files. So we need again the freeglut extracted folder and copy again the include and library files over here so Visual Studio can find them, and as well in the bin folder copy the freeglut.dll to the Windows folder. This is just the same, but the important one for the Visual Studio users, go to this folder here. Okay, this was just a quick one for the Visual Studio guys. So let's get into coding. First of all, we are doing this in C++ now, so we need to include the proper header files to get all the necessary OpenGL functionality that we want to use. And if we are starting to do this, we need to make sure, first of all, what system we are on. So there is this this kind of coding where you can say, okay, if I'm on an Apple system, he should include something else. He should include, in our case, glut.h, which just means this one is including the header files on an Apple system. And we don't want an S, we need an else case here. So if we are not on an Apple system, assuming we're on a Windows system, we want to go to GL and use this one here. So this one should just include the proper files for us, the header files of glut. What we need as well is, just for simplicity of it, include some stdio.h, which means just another header file for C++ to allow us to do some command line outputs, because maybe we want to show some information on the command line. So this is just for us to include the OpenGL stuff, because this glut file will automatically include all the OpenGL functions available here. So we just go ahead coding this one. So, like in any C++ program, I'm not quite sure what program language are your preferred ones. Of course, we need some kind of main function. So we go with a main function here. And this, of course, has default arguments. At least on a Windows system, they are like this, but I guess it should be on a different system as well. So that's just our main function. This is just the one that will be called when the system starts. So now we need to do some stuff to get our window, and this window should be able to display OpenGL stuff. So this is what glut or freeglut will help us to do, because these are functions already implemented in freeglut. So first of all, we need to, let's say, initialize this entire freeglut system. I'm writing some comments on this one. Start up freeglut, although this may be not the right way to say it, but I just write like this. You could change the comment later for something that you can understand in a better way. So this is glut init. That's an existing function. And this one gets just the command line arguments that the main function got as well. So it's this one here, and it's this one here. So this, first of all, just initializes freeglut for us. That's all we want to do right now. Just information as well, if you can't type along all the time, of course I will provide the file that we coded here later as a Dropbox link for each of you, and so you could download this later. But if you type along, I guarantee you that you will better understand what we're doing here. So next thing we want to do, we need to tell what kind of window we want to have and what kind of OpenGL functionality we want to use in this window. So it's glut init display mode. And now we're indeed giving some information about the OpenGL that we're going to use. We just will write it down right now, and we will explain it later as we go on. So there are some given information behind this constants here. This means we are going to use double buffering. then we need to tell the window that we are going to use RGB alpha color space, which means all the color channels plus an alpha channel. And as well, we want to have depth information in our 3D scene. Without depth information, it's just 2D, but we want to do 3D, so we need depth information. So it's glut. Oh, depths. So this just sets the proper modes for our window. So double buffering, RGB alpha color space, and depth information should be available. And these are just the parameters we need to pass to this function. Okay, next thing we want to do with that is a simple one. We don't need to do this, but we do right now. How big should our window be? So let's just glut init window. Oh, come on. Window size. Here it is. And of course, these are just values to be given to tell how big our window should be. And once we've got this one, we can also tell where on the page our window should be located. So let's just do this. That's not necessary, but we just do it so you get an idea what kind of functionalities you have available here. And I just place it 100 from top left. Okay. These are just settings for our window. Now we need to tell them, okay, go ahead and create our window. And that's glut create window, telling him the title of our window, and we just call it first OpenGL app, for example. So that's just a string here passed to this function to create a window. Okay, and this should be fine. This should already create a window for us, but I guess it would disappear right away. So we just add some more stuff here. At least we need one thing. We need to tell OpenGL or the FreeGLUT system, as soon as the window has started, it should go into a permanent loop. It should loop over and over again, always drawing the scene in 30 frames, 60 frames. We change this one later. But we need to tell him, okay, run as long as I tell you to stop again. So this is also included in the glut, and it's called the glut main loop. And after all this is done and our main function should return in the end, we need a return 0 to just show everything was fine. I'm not quite sure if this window will stay open. We just give it a try, but let's just see. I'm rebuilding it right now. Oh, and I've got a bunch of errors here. Why should it have not been declared in this scope? Come on, that's bullshit. Let me check my includes here. That looks better. I'm sorry, there was a spelling error in the includes at top. Oh yes, I misspelled include. I'm sorry for that. Of course it's include. Include. Oh no, come on. So, in the end it should be like this. Include is the proper word. I misspelled it. I'm sorry. So, rebuilding this one. Works fine, and we see we don't have any errors here. And let me just see what happens if I run this one. Yeah, that's what we get. We get a window which is not really showing proper content because we are not doing anything in this window. This window is prepared to display OpenGL content, but we are not doing it, so we get just some broken window here, let's say. But that's fine. First of all, our window is working. It has the proper name, and we can close it, and we are fine. Just give me a second to check the chats here so I can reply to you if necessary. Okay, some of you got problems there getting errors. No display callback registered for window 1. Yes, that's right. That's an error that occurs because we haven't done everything that we should do. On my side, it's working like this. But we will fill it up now, and I'm pretty sure in a few seconds it will be running on your machine. Yes, let's just go on. Let's just fill it up so you understand what's going on there. The error that you get is we are telling OpenGL we are telling Freegler to go in a loop and to loop over and over again, but we have not told him till now what should you do in the loop, what should you do every frame. So this is what we need to add here. We need to give him a so-called callback function. That means this loop is calling a function for us over and over again. And that's quite simple. We just go with glut display function and tell him the name of the function. And we call it, let's say, just display. This will be the name of a function that we will create now. So this is the function that we tell him to call whenever something is to be displayed. And Freeglut just knows another kind of function that we should give him. That's glut, how is it called? The idle function. And this is not the perfect way to do it, but we are a bit lazy now, so we tell him display as well. So we use the same function for both of them. That's not what you should do in a productive system, but for us right now it's fine. Later we may split this up. So now we've told him there is a function that you should call every time you render a frame, but of course we need to create this function. So we should add this function here above the main function, telling him void display. We don't need any parameters here, and we just want to have this display function. So you see we've got this function now to tell him this is what you should call over and over again whenever you are drawing a frame. For those of you who got this error which says callback registered, no callback registered for window 1, this error should now go away because now you have registered callback functions for the displaying. So let's just see if it's working now on your side like this. Still no error on my side, and still this broken window, which is still fine because we haven't drawn anything in the OpenGL scene. But at least your error should go away, which tells you that you have not registered a callback for displaying. So just check this one and give me a feedback in the chat if you still have this problem. That would be strange. Okay, working now. Thanks for the feedback. Working, great. Okay, then I guess we solved the problem. The window is showing and staying, yes. Okay, still we haven't drawn any OpenGL stuff so far. We've just created a window which is able to show OpenGL stuff. And now we really need to take care to do some OpenGL stuff for our window. So what we need as well, now there are really a few steps to be taken. Whenever someone says CodeBlocks is crashing on his side, please just tag along with us while we're going on here. We may check later what's going wrong on your side. Anyway, if you code with us, in the end, you've got a working program and we just need to make some modifications in your system to get it running. So just hang on and follow us, please. So what we need to do now, certain steps there. First of all, whenever a window is created or a window is changing its size, OpenGL needs to know this because it needs to change some stuff there. So we need to tell the system another callback function that it should call whenever the window is changing. And even the creation of a window is a change of a window. So we need another function here that is called glut reshape function. And we just call this reshape as well. So let's just call this function reshape. Once again, this one is called as soon as the window is created or anytime the window is changing its size. So we need this function. And again, this function has a void return value, which means it doesn't return at all. But it has two parameters, because this function automatically gets from the window system the width and the height of the new window size. So we get an integer for the width, and we get an integer for the height of the window. And so we've got this function, and it's able to take the values. So let me check the chat. Okay, so now we go on. Once we've got the basic setup here, we need to come up with the OpenGL related stuff. So, and the reshape function is actually a function where we need to call the first real OpenGL function call. And this one is called GL. You always realize OpenGL functions as they start with GL in the beginning. GL viewport. And this one, we just bring in the parameters and I explain you right away what this means. Viewport gets four parameters. In our case, it's 0, 0, and then the width and the height of the window. So what does this mean? I will show you once more when I run my window. Okay, let me make it smaller. Yes, although my window is broken when it comes to the content in it, still it's a window. So what is the viewport all about? The viewport means in which part of this window should OpenGL draw. And when I tell him 0, 0, it starts at the lower left corner of the window. And then I tell him width and height, how far to the right and how far to the top should you go and draw from there. So 0, 0 means starting on the lower left side, going all the way to the right side to the window and all the way to the top of the window. If I would go here and tell him divide by 2 width and height and count with the window again, this would mean in the window it would just start at the lower left side and only go 50% to the right and 50% to the top, till here. So we would draw this lower left part of the window and the rest would stay untouched. So you can really tell OpenGL in which part of the window it should draw. And this is what GL viewport does and what it needs to do every time we resize the window. And now you realize why it's important to have this reshape function every time a window resizes, because we want our OpenGL to draw in the entire window. So I will remove these numbers again and tell him to draw in the entire window, which means starting 0, 0, lower left side, going all the way to the right and all the way to the top to draw on the to the upper right side. That's something that you will encounter quite often in OpenGL, that these kind of information are always given from lower left side to upper right side. Okay, this is just to tell OpenGL we are drawing in the entire window, but you just realized still the window is not showing us good content. Let me just once more check the chat, just a second. So, still, some of you that follow along have some problems with the compiler, but as I just said, please just code along, and after we've done the workshop, we may have a screen share on your system, and we just may correct this one on your system. But when you've got the code later, you should be fine. It's just a minor change, and then it's running on your system as well. Okay, but let's get us back to OpenGL here. This is our reshape function, and the GL viewport is something that we need to do here. We will extend this function later, but for now we are fine. So I just fold it in, and the display function is not needed right now as well. I fold it in as well. We need one more function that will just make our basic OpenGL configuration, let's say. So I'm going to create a function called void init OpenGL. That's just the name that I come up with myself. You could call this whatever you want, and of course you should at least write init so it makes sense somehow. I'm misspelling everything today, I'm sorry. OpenGL, that would be better. Okay, so what we need to do here, we need to make some basic OpenGL settings. And first of all, we will set the background color. It feels like the background color, although it's not perfectly as the background color, but our window should have a color when there is nothing drawn at all. And this is called the GL clear color. And this takes the values for RGB and alpha as small float values. This is what we will use now here. So let's first of all make it a black background. 0.0, 0.0, 0.0. And the alpha channel is special. You could either put it 1 or 0. That's all the same. Let's put it 1.0 now. So this just tells OpenGL every time that it's done with one frame and it's starting a new one, it needs to draw over everything. And what color should it use? So this is the color it should use to overdraw everything which has been drawn in the previous frame, because this is how OpenGL works. It's just building up a scene, drawing everything in its place, and when it's done, everything is overdrawn and it's redrawn again. So this is the color that will be used to overdraw everything. But this only sets the color. This does not tell OpenGL to use it. That's the point. So we've set this color, and we need to do some more settings to be fine with our OpenGL. But we will do them later once the basic systems is running fine so far. So we've got the color set now probably, and now we want OpenGL to really overdraw the background of our window with this color, because till now you realized the background of our window was always broken somehow. So we go to the display function, because this one is called every frame, every time, over and over again. So this is the right place to draw the background color, let's say. And this is called GL clear, which means this function uses the clear color to draw over the background of the window. And we need to tell him GL color buffer bit. This means, in simple words, use my defined background color to overdraw the entire background of the window. And once we've got these few changes in our system, we should be fine with the window having a black background color. But of course, I have not used this function till now. We should do this. We should do this somewhere here, maybe. Definitely after the create window, of course. We should place it here. So when our program starts, it's creating our window. It's setting our, let's say, background color. It's telling the system which is the callback function to use every frame. And this function is called every frame, and every frame it's overdrawing the background with our defined color. And if I haven't misspelled anything till now, This should work. Let's give it a try. Compiling well, running it. Still not working on my side. Let's see what I have forgotten till now. We've got the clear color, we've got the display. Spray fun main loop, that's all fine. That's also fine. Oh yes, I forgot one important point. As we told OpenGL, we want to use double buffering. Let me just give you a quick introduction to double buffering. Double buffering means we've got the main display, our monitor, and we've got another piece of memory somewhere in your RAM, which is just made up the same way as the memory which is displayed on your monitor. So you've got two pieces of memory which can be filled with the information to be displayed on the screen. And you just write in one piece of them, and once you've done this, you flip over to the other one writing there while this one is displayed on the screen. So this is the double buffering. So you don't need to draw in the memory which is displayed on the screen. But to tell OpenGL, okay, now I'm done with drawing in this piece, show it on the screen, you need to call another function. And this is what I forgot here. I need to call the function glut swap buffers, which does exactly what it says. It's swapping the buffers, the front and back buffer, how they are called, from the double buffering. And this one should lead to the fact that we've got our black background on the screen. I hope I'm fine now. Let's see. Checking this one and running it. Yes, and here we go. This is what you should see right now. You should see a black window. And this is really your first OpenGL window having the black background. This is the basis for everything. This is just what we need to get started. So to sum it up once more, what we need. Of course, we need our main function. We need to tell OpenGL, or in this case, FreeGLUT, how our window should be created. We need to set our background color, although it's not really a background color, but it feels like. And we need to tell them what functions should you call over and over again to display my scene. And of course, this reshape function, very important. Every time the window gets resized, OpenGL needs to know how big is the window now. So where is the part of the window where I need to draw? And this main loop here is calling this permanent loop, which is over and over again calling these functions here. So this is what's happening. This is called, I guess, depending on your machine speed, 100 or 1,000 times per second now. And it's always overwriting everything with the background color, and then swapping between the two different pieces of memories which are shown on the display then. So just to show you that we're really drawing now this color here, it's quite simple. You could just go ahead, change the red channel, because these are always color channels. Let me write like this. So it's red, green, blue, alpha. We just changed the red channel. This values go from 0 to 1. 1 means it's fully red, 0 means there's no red at all. So I just change it to 0.8, for example. And I'm stopping the program running here. I'm rebuilding it. Yes, I want to rebuild it. And I'm running this one. And surprise, surprise, I've got a red background. So this is really our basic setup for the window. Of course, that's not very spectacular till now, but this is what we need. This is our basis. We need to have this window to be able to draw anything. So you should have this one. I will just go for a 5-minute break. So each of you can grab something to eat, get a coffee or a beer, depending on your time zone. And we'll be back in a few minutes to go on. From this point, we will start to begin really drawing geometry, drawing a triangle onto the screen. But first of all, a 5-minute break for each of us, just to catch up with what we've done so far and to maybe get some fresh air as well. Okay, see you in 5 minutes then. So, we are back again. I hope you have something to drink or to eat, or you just catch up some fresh air. Let's get back to coding here. So, we've now got our basic setup. You should have the black window by now. But of course, that's not very spectacular. I just fold in all the functions here because the only thing we need from now on, first of all, will be this display function, because the basic setup is right, the window is there, and we know it's running in this permanent loop and always calling the display function to show our scene. So we need to work in the display function. And we need to work between these two function calls, because this one here is the beginning of each frame, which means it's overwriting the last frame. And this one here tells OpenGL somehow, okay, I'm ready, show what I've drawn till now. And so this is somehow the beginning and the end of each render call, it should be. So everything that we want to do needs to happen in between. And this is what we're going to do right now. So we need to talk, first of all, how does OpenGL manage its data? How can you give data to OpenGL? Well, we want to draw in 3D space. So of course, we need to provide 3D data. And 3D data means we always need to have X, Y, and Z coordinates for points in space. And this is what we will do here. And we need to know, when we tell OpenGL the points, what do I want to draw with these points? We can draw just points, really just points in space. We can draw lines, which means, of course, we always need to have two points in space to connect them. And the major shape in OpenGL, or the so-called primitive, is a triangle, which means we define three corner points, tell OpenGL, okay, this one should be a triangle, and OpenGL will first of all put the points into space and then create a surface between these three points for us. And this is a big advantage of OpenGL. And while we're at this place here, there may be some more background information needed for you as well. The commands that we are creating right now, these draw commands, where we tell OpenGL draw something for me, this really starts to send data to the graphic card, and actually the graphic card is calculating the 3D object that gets visible for us. So we are leaving the CPU somehow, we are leaving our main application, and we are sending data to the graphic card, and the graphic card is processing it for us, and this is what makes it even possible to have all this great visual effects that you know from today's games, because the graphic card can run way faster, it can run stuff in parallel. The CPU would not be able to do all this stuff. So let's get started. First of all, we need to tell OpenGL we want to draw something, but just a second, let me check the chat once more. Okay, seems to be fine, everybody's there. So we want to draw something. And when we want to draw something, there are different ways to do it. We will use a very basic OpenGL way, and you may even say it's the old way, but for the basic understanding, I guess it's the best way to start. So there's a function, an OpenGL function called glBegin, and this really just means I want to begin drawing something, and we need to tell OpenGL, what do I want to draw? We want to draw triangles, so there's an existing constant for this, which is called GL. Oh, come on. Triangles. And whenever you begin something, you need to end it as well. So there's a function GL end, which takes no parameter. But this just tells OpenGL, okay, I want to begin drawing and I want to draw triangles, and I end the drawing at this point. So everything that we will put in between those will start to draw triangles for us. So first of all, if we don't put a color to a triangle, we may hardly recognize it. So we need to tell OpenGL first of all, okay, I want to set a color for all the points that I'm going to draw now. So there is a function for this, or there are indeed many functions for setting the color. We just use color S3F, which means we are providing the color information as three floats. That's what this 3F means. And let's make our triangle quite green in this case. So we put the red channel to 0, the green channel to 1, and the blue channel to 0 again. This just sets the color for all following geometric information that we are going to send to the graphic card. So everything that we are sending now will become green. So let's send something to the graphic card. And this is a function called glVertex3F, which means again, we are providing the geometric information as three floats. So let me just write some comments here for you to be able to better understand it later. Set the color for all upcoming draw calls . So this is setting the color, and again, this is something that you will see very often in OpenGL. It's just again red, green, and blue. So R, G, B values. And now we need to tell them, okay, create a geometric point for me. So I just told you how to create a geometric point. It's very simple. It's just X, Y, and Z. And as the default OpenGL space, let's say, is in a range from -1 to +1 on all the three axes, we will just pick values right now which are in the space. So the first point may be somewhere on the left side. That means on the X coordinate, we are maybe -0.5, a bit to the left side. Remember, the OpenGL space is from -1 to +1, -1 to +1, -1 to +1. The default OpenGL space. This is what we're working in. So I put this one to a bit to the left side, maybe a bit lower on the Y-X, again, -0.5. And on the Z-X, which is the depth, somehow into the scene, I just put it to 0, because that's fine when it's just somewhere there. So this one, first of all, defines one geometric point for us. But of course, we want to draw a triangle, and triangle can only be drawn if we've got three points. So we just go ahead and copy this line, and I just write another comment here for you as well, which says X, Y, and Z. Again, X, Y, and Z. That's the default geometric system of OpenGL. So of course, we need to change the points now a bit. The second point, the first point is on the lower left side. The next one should be on the lower right side. So I just change the X value of the second point from -0.5 to +0.5. And now the point which completes our triangle should be somewhere in the middle at the top. So the X coordinate could be 0, because that's just in the middle. And the Y coordinate could be a positive 0.5. This should really form up a triangle, lower left, lower right, somewhere in the middle on the top. So if I have done anything right, this should give us a triangle on the screen. So let's try. Let me rebuild this one. No arrows so far. And let me run it. And here we go. This is what you should see in your window as well. Perfectly aligned triangle in the window. This point here at the lower left side is our first point. Lower right side is our second point, and the point at the top is our third point. These are really just the coordinates. Because once more, this default geometric system in OpenGL is going from minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1 in depth. And of course, right in the middle, we've got the point 0, 0, 0. So this is what you should get right now. I just give you a few seconds to check this one, maybe even play around with this one, and to check the chat on my side. So, here we are again. You should have this nice little window with your green triangle. And you should also realize when you scale, when you scale it, it scales accordingly with your window. This is why we did this reshape function for. If we don't have this reshape function, it would all look crappy. Okay, but that's not very spectacular so far, but we go through it step by step. Let me just check the chat. GL viewport. Yes, one of you has the triangle always on the lower left side. Let me just show you this one. So one of you has the triangle always on the lower left side of his window. You may need to check if you really have this viewport function set up properly. Let me show you the viewport function that I set up on my side again. First of all, very important, in the main function you need to define this one here, GL reshape function reshape. So it calls the function of our own every time the window is resized. And in the reshape function, it should be like this: GL viewport 00 width and height. This should lead to the fact that the triangle is really always in the middle of your screen. Of course, only if you have chosen this coordinates, of course. But this is how it should look like. So for the... Okay, the guy changed it, now it's working. Perfect, then we can go on. So, that's not spectacular so far, I agree, but we are going through it step by step. And I guess you realize by now we are doing this really quite slowly, but I want to... this is why I provided this workshop for the real beginners among you. If you have never heard about OpenGL, I guess it's better to start real slow. Be patient with me if you think I'm going too slow because you know about OpenGL, but I really want to give the chance for each of you to catch up with the topic. Okay, so now we've got a triangle and all points are green. That's fine, but that's not enough for us, of course. We want to have at least the three corner points of the triangle in different colors and have a nice gradient over the entire triangle. Okay, just one more question on the chat, sorry. He's asking how we got the background red. Once more, we've got the time to do it. We've got this function init OpenGL. And once more as well, you should call this function in your main function after the create window. And here you need to change the color for the red value to get the red background. Make sure you call this function and make sure this one here has a value for the red set. Okay, But back to our triangle, we want to color the corner points right now. So what do we need to do? Well, we set a color, and you have you saw that the color is always the same for each of these three points. And this is how OpenGL works. This is what OpenGL is. OpenGL is a so-called state machine. And state means you just set one state to a value, and this state is used as long as you change it to a different value, which means we set the state for the color to green, and we draw all these points using this state of green, which means if we want to have one of the points in different color, we need to change the state, we need to change the color. And this is what we're going to do right now. Let's copy this line and insert it between the first and the second point here, the first and the second vertex. Just to catch up on this one as well, whenever you give a 3D or 2D point by X, Y, and Z in OpenGL, the name in OpenGL for this one is vertex. Sorry, I should have explained this one before. But a vertex just means 3D point given by X, Y, and Z, nothing else. Okay, so we set a color to green. We draw our first point. Now we want to set the color to, let's say, red. So changing the red value to 1, changing the green value to 0, and the blue value should stay 0. And we are drawing the second point. And of course, as the third point as well should have a different color, we copy this function once more and as well set the color state for the third point separately. So this one means setting the color to green for the first point we draw, setting the color to red for the second point we draw, and then setting the color for blue for the third point that we draw. And if we do it like this, let me just put the functions together to be closer to one another. If we do it like this, then all the three points should have different colors. So let's just go ahead and check if I'm right here, if I'm telling you bullshit. Okay, on my side, it looks like this. And it should as well look on your side quite like this. So what we've got now, for each of the points, we defined a different color. And you see that the three corner points really have the full color value, but along the surface of the triangle, we've got this nice gradient. We've got this nice color interpolation. Just make sure this one is working on your side. I give you a 1 minute break. And after this one, I explain you how do we get this interpolation on the surface. But this is what you should have on your side right now. Okay, so here we are again, and you see that we've got our triangle with the three corner points being colored. And without any work of us, just by some magic, we've got this nice gradient all along the triangle. So how is this working? That's the so-called rasterization of OpenGL. Whenever you give OpenGL some geometric points and some colors and tell them, okay, here's the data, go ahead and draw it. All this data goes through the so-called OpenGL pipeline. And this takes different steps. And I guess in SQL workshops, we will as well take a closer look at this pipeline. But for now, it's just important for you to know about the rasterization today, because we are defining, like in this image here, we are defining three corner points. And of course, if you just have three corner points, this does not form up surface. But the rasterization of OpenGL goes ahead and calculates all the pixels, or the so-called fragments in OpenGL. All the pixels are calculated by OpenGL. And for all of the pixels, it does this interpolation. It checks the color values of the corner points and just interpolates the proper color for the pixel it's just processing by the values of the corner points. And this is all happening on the graphic card, all in parallel processing done by OpenGL for us. So we don't need to take care about it. But I just wanted to show you this image here to get a better idea what's going on there, because later you will definitely need to have a better understanding of what is going on in the rasterization. But as I said, that may be just relevant for one of the SQL workshops. So let's get back to our code. Let me move this one here. Let's get back here. Okay, so we've got a triangle. That's fine so far. But in most of the cases, of course, we don't only want to draw one thing. We want to draw multiple things. We will come to this one pretty soon. But first of all, what about a bit movement? I guess having a static triangle is fine, but without movement, everything looks a bit blah, a bit pale. So let's bring in some movement. So here is where we need to work with the so-called OpenGL matrix stack. Because whenever you do a movement in OpenGL or in any 3D program, you need to have a matrix which describes the rotation or translation of an object. Luckily, in this OpenGL version that we are working right now, there are given functions for this, so we don't need to take care about it too much. So let's just jump into the code right away and bring in some rotation to our triangle. So, as we want our triangle to be rotated, as we want all the points to be rotated the same way, we need to come up with the rotation above this GL begin call. So, in the simplest way, and I need to admit, I haven't done this in this simple way quite a long time, so I just give it a try. Be patient with me if it fails. We should just tell him rotate. GL rotate F, so rotate by float value. And this one gets, again, a few parameters. The first parameter is the angle. How much should it rotate? Let's make it 45 degrees. And then let's tell him what is the vector it's rotating around. So for example, if we tell him 0.0, 1.0, 0.0, this means it's a vector like this. So you have an x like this, and if you're rotating around this, everything is rotating around this x. So telling him 45 degree rotated around this vector would just mean exactly something like this. So this one has automatically effect on all the points that we are drawing after this one. So let's just see what's happening here. I admit that's not the proper way to do it, but I want to keep it simple right now. So let me just see if it fails or if it's running fine. Well, it is fine, not as I expected, but it's fine right now. That's not what I wanted to achieve, but it's at least giving you some impression that rotation is working. It's looking a bit freaky, but you see it's really just rotating around this X, And as it's rotating by 45 degrees over and over again, it's just moving very, very quick. So let's change the value of the rotation. Let's just make it 1, so it should rotate a bit slower in the end. Okay, saving this one, rebuilding, and starting it again. This looks way better. This is what we actually want to achieve. A smooth spinning triangle. Okay. Just give it a try. This is what you should get right now. So what is happening right now by this GL rotate F function, which means rotate by float value. What is happening right now is it's rotating our matrix, our basic matrix describing our 3D world right now, always by 1 degree over and over again, which means every frame that we're drawing, it's rotating on and on. Usually that's not what you want to do. For our simple use case here, it's fine, but we will come now to a different point where we will change this behavior because we want to have more control over the rotation. And if we rotate on and on, we lose this control. But first of all, just I'm giving you another minute to play around with this one to make sure it's working on your side before we go on, and I can just check the chat in the meantime. First of all, just I'm giving you another minute to play around with this one to make sure it's working on your side before we go on, and I can just check the chat in the meantime. So here we are again. Hopefully this one is spinning smoothly for all of you. But this is not the right way to do it. So we need to come up with a few more functions to manipulate and to handle this matrices, this matrix, which is describing the rotation of the triangle. So first of all, we are now over and over again using the same matrix to always rotate it by additionally 1 degree. And as I just said before, we are losing control somehow. How far has it been rotated till now? So we need to come up with the usual OpenGL way, which means always get everything into a straight initial mode. And when you know the straight initial mode, you can rotate it to its position. So we will go into the display function again. And we will come up with another OpenGL function called before the GL rotate F, which is called GL load identity, which means it's somehow resetting the current matrix that we use for the rotation back to normal. It's just setting up to an identity matrix, which means it's just straight, there's no rotation at all, so we are setting it back. And we are doing this every frame. And now we can change the rotation value back to 45, for example. And if we do this and we compile it and we run it, we will see that the triangle will always stay in the same 45 degree rotated position. It's no more spinning at all, it's just at this position. But that's the proper way to do it, because we always tell OpenGL, okay, everything back to basic, everything back to identity, and then rotate it to the position I want to have. This gives us more control over the rotation itself. So let me check if I compile this one and run it. Yes, this is what I want to have. So, you see that the triangle is a bit rotated. Of course, it's hard to see it because it's no longer spinning, but it's not as big as it was before. It's 45 degrees rotated. I could just make it even more visible if I go ahead and make it, let's say, 75 degrees. Rebuild this one and run it. And then it's quite obvious. It's somehow rotated. That's what we want to achieve. Although you think it was nicer before spinning all around, but this way you've got the control of it. You know, whenever you draw this triangle somewhere in your scene, you know it's 75 degrees rotated. The other way we did it, we had no control about the angle because we need to measure how many frames has it already run, what rotation is it till now. So that's a proper way to do it. So this allows us even something else, and this is why I implemented this one. Let me set this one back to 45 degrees. And now we want to come up with an additional triangle. So let's copy this entire block here, because this is all that we need to draw a triangle in a rotation that we want to have it. Copy this entire block from load identity to GLEnd. So I'm copying it and I'm pasting it below. So I'm just writing a comment here. Second triangle. Okay, before I draw the second triangle, again, I call this load identity, which means I've done changes for the first triangle, but I want to rewind these changes before I draw the second triangle. And the second triangle, I will give the 75 degree value. And now we've got just one problem remaining. Both triangles are exactly at the same coordinates. So we need to change somehow some of the coordinates. But we could do another trick first of all. We could change the color. We could just make the second triangle in a different color. So right now it's green, red, blue. And I would change the color order to red, green, oh no, red, blue, and green. Just to be able to see the difference between the two triangles. That's not a very nice way, but we will improve this in a second. Sorry, I forgot some numbers here. So just make sure you copied the entire block. You change the rotation value to a different one than the one from the first triangle. And you just change, for example, the colors for the second triangle to be different than the ones from the first triangle. With this one, we should already be able to tell the difference between the two triangles. Let me just try. I guess we need to nicen this one up a bit later. But yes, it works if you take a look at this one. So we see the 45 degree rotated triangle somehow in the background, and we see as well the other triangle here which is 75 degree rotating and which has the different color settings. I guess I messed up the color settings. Oh no, they are fine because they are already overlapping somehow. Let me just check. Red, blue, and green. Shouldn't it be green on top? Oh no, I made it red again. I'm sorry. This one here is wrong. Should be green here. I just messed up the colors. Yes. That's actually what I wanted to achieve. So, we've got these two triangles. They are rotated differently, but still they are not perspectively correct. But we do this one later. First of all, we are fine with this setting. Now, let's just make this a bit more easy to recognize. We need to move the second triangle, let's say a bit to the left and a bit upper, so we can really tell the difference between the two of them. So I'm changing the vertex information, the 3D coordinates of the second triangle, to different values. So moving it more to the left always means going to the negative x values. So I make this 0.9 minus 0.9, and I want to move it a bit upwards. That means making the y value a bit more positive. Let's say minus 0.1. And for the other values, I need just to change this accordingly. So this one here could be at this point, this one as well here. And I just need to erase the point here and put it as well a bit more to the left. So this is just playing around with the coordinates. There is no deeper logic in this. I'm just trying to figure out some coordinates which are fine showing the triangles alongside each other. So let me just check if I have guessed right values. Oh no, I messed it up. That's not good. Let me change the values. This one is fine. It's on the left side. It's pretty fine. This one is there and there. It's pretty fine as well. X is minus 1. No, this should be minus 5, for example. This should make a bit more sense. Just playing around with the values. Still far away from perfect, I agree, but I just need to correct the figures. Okay, but now we see already, these are really two triangles. And they are differently positioned in space. I'm really wondering why this one is so wrong. Anyway, I will, this is fine for us. So what we want to do now, we want to spin one triangle while the other one stays in place. So that's very important when it comes to 3D data and you need to manage them. You always need to define the rotation for one of them separately from another one. So let's get the triangle in the back, the big one, spinning all the time while the other one stays as it is. That means we need an additional variable in our code because we just need to have a variable which is counting up. So we are just implementing a new variable, and that could be a global one. Just make a float variable, let's say counter equals 0.0. That's just a variable for us that we can use to count up every frame so we have a permanent spinning rotation. So just make this global variable at the very top. And then you can go into the display function, which is just right here. and tell him to use this counter variable for the angle, so it will be spinning by this value. And of course, we need to increase the value. Let's do it like this. So every frame, it's increasing the value by 0.1. If you are not familiar with C++, that's just counting up 0.1 onto the value of this variable. So just by bringing in this global variable and counting it up and using it for the rotate function, one of the triangles will spin, while the other triangle always rotates by the same 75 degree value. And this is only possible because we are using this load identity calls over and over again. So we are always setting everything back to default identity values and then start to rotate from this position. And for the first triangle, we are using the counter. For the second triangle, we are staying with the fixed angle. So let's just check if this one will work. It works, but way too slow. Let me increase the value, I'm sorry. Let's make this 1.1, otherwise it's so slow that we can't realize it. Okay, and here we go. So now we got two separate objects in our scene, two triangles. One is spinning, the other one is staying as it is. And that's the basic concept of 3D data being displayed in scenes, that you have a so-called rotation value or rotation matrix for every object in the scene, and you can rotate it one way or the other way. Just play around with these values for 1 minute, and then we go ahead and we'll start to translate, to move around the triangle as well, and maybe even to scale it down or scale it up a bit. But first of all, make sure that you've got a result somehow like this, depending on the coordinates, of course. I'll just give you a one minute break on this one, and then we go on with moving the triangle around. Okay, hopefully this is working for you. I just saw in the chat that someone wrote, even with the value of 1, it's spinning fast as hell on his device. There's a setting for your graphic card that's called vertical sync, which means, let's say your monitor is running at 60 Hz, which means it's refreshing the picture every 60 times per second. When you enable the so-called vertical sync on your graphic card, you will only get this 60 seconds refresh somehow. If you deactivate it, the triangle may spin way, way faster. So that's just an information here. you should always, in the end, you will always create a 3D program in that way that you have a so-called FPS balancer, which means you are taking care that the frames are really just running at 30 or 60 frames per second by just inserting some sleep or something like this. But just an information here for you, why it may be spinning very fast on your side or even slower on your side. But let's get back to our triangles. We want to move them. We want to move them from the left to the right. We just want to position them in space properly. And good point to start is the second one. As this one is still, let me open it once more. As this one is still too much above the other one, I want to rotate it a bit more. I want to move it a bit more to the left side. So to the left and maybe a bit to the top. So how can we achieve this? Again, just like the rotation, moving stuff around in 3D involves a matrix. And just like this GL rotate F is manipulating a matrix, there's a function as well to manipulate a matrix in a way that it's moving stuff around. And luckily, there's just another function for this one in OpenGL as well. That's GL translate F, which means we are translating by float value. And the parameters here are very logic indeed, because we just need to tell him how far should you move along the axis. So for X, Y, and that, how far should you move? Well, I want my triangle to move to the left side. So I need to tell him on the X, you should move by 0.5 to the left side. And the rest of the values should not be changed at all. So by just bringing in this line, my second triangle, because I'm just doing this for the second triangle, should be moved to the left side. So let's give it a try. It's building, it's running, and this is what I wanted to achieve. You see, it's working. It just moved the one triangle to the left side. And I could even move it there a bit more, but that's just now playing around with the figures. I could even move it to the bottom, let's say. So let's move it on a negative value of 0.8 on the y-x. So it's going down to the bottom of the window, hopefully. Yeah, that's fine. But again, that's just playing around with the values. But you should play around with those, because this is what you can do. You can move stuff around by using GL translate, which tells you moving to the left, to the right. Once again, make sure you are not choosing figures which are too big, because still we are in this OpenGL default space going from -1 to +1, which means if you move this triangle by -5, it's just out of view. It just leaves the area that we can see in our 3D scene. So just keep the figures small to see it's moving. If you keep your figures somewhere between -1 and +1, you should definitely be fine and see a good result. So now one triangle is spinning. We are able to move the other one around. Of course, we can combine these two facts. We can move something around and spin it while it's moving. So let's do this. So let's grab this GL translate function here and just copy it. And then we go to the first triangle and paste it just after this GL load identity. So we've got this function which is doing the translation, which is doing the movement for the first triangle as well. And just give me a second to check the chat. Okay. There's just one info in the chat that says it's, of course, it makes a difference if you translate and rotate first. I just show you this one in a second. But let's just get this one here. Let's move our first triangle. And we don't want to move it just once and place it somewhere. We want to move it permanently. And this is why we can make use again of our variable, which is counting up all the time. So let's grab this one. And because I don't want it to move that fast, I will divide this one by 10, let's say. And I don't want any other movement on the other axis. So it's just rotating by this value divided. This is our value for rotating, but I want to divide it by 10 to have smaller values to move it along the x-axis. So when I'm starting my scene right now, I'm not quite sure how fast it will run. My triangle should move to the right and should slowly go move out of sight. I will reduce this value so you can see it better, because my window was opening on a different monitor and I need to move it here. So let's try this one. It's still moving way too fast, I'm sorry. Let's reduce the value even more so I can show you the result. Here we go, you see it's rotating and spinning. We can use quite a simple trick. As it's moving out of sight, we can just bring in some logic. As soon as this value reaches a certain amount, we bring it back to a value close enough to zero to start again. So I'll come up with something simple here. If counter value is bigger than, let's say, 200, then it should be reset to, first of all, zero, to make it very simple. Which means we now implement for the rotation and the movement just some kind of loop that is happening inside our section that we can actually see. Let me check if this one is working fine. Yes, here we go. This is what I wanted to achieve. So it's moving by our variable counter and it's rotating on its way. So we already brought in the two major movements that you can do in 3D. You can move something along the axis and you can rotate it as you go. And of course, if you do this depending on a variable which is increasing its data, you have some ongoing permanent movement. So just check out your code to behave like this, to bring in all this data. I'll leave you alone with the view of the code and the rotating image for a second, and then I'll come back and we go on manipulating the triangles even more. Okay. So hopefully each of you was able to get something similar to this. So at least one triangle rotating and spinning, or the other one just being translated or rotated to a final position. That's just the difference between having a value, a variable, describing a permanent change, or having just a static value describing the final position of something. So this both has a use case in real 3D programming. Let's just think this triangle would not be a triangle, but would be a building. This building would not move and would not rotate at all in a 3D scene, unless it's a very strange 3D scene. And this other triangle may be a football flying around. This one, of course, would move and rotate along its way. So both of these have a proper use case in 3D space. You just need to know, is it something that it's moving permanently, or is it something with a static position? And then the approach is slightly different. But you see, it's just by the value of the translate and rotate function. So let's do something more. First of all, I want my triangle, which is spinning around, going out on the right side, coming back on the left side again of my screen. That means I just need to change this value here, because I could just put this one to minus 200, just changing the value slightly. This should already get me to that point that it's flying out on the right side. Yes, that's what I want to achieve. Coming back on the right side again. Nothing spectacular, but now I really got some kind of loop where my triangle is always going through the scene. But what bothers me right now is both of the triangles are on the same ZX. They're on the same depths, and still I don't see them overlapping. And we need to change this, because without this it's not really a 3D scene. Right now it's somehow a 2D scene, but to really make it a 3D scene, we need to know if a part of this triangle is overlapping the part of the other triangle. So what do we need to do for this one? We need to tell OpenGL that we want to use the so-called depth information. So how deep is some object inside my 3D scene? So let's just go and implement this. This of course needs to be done only once, and we've got this function called initOpenGL. And I guess that's the best place to put it. So after we defined our clear color, which is somehow our background color, we just bring in the information for OpenGL, hey, I want to use depth information. And whenever we tell OpenGL, hey, I want to use something, there's a given function for this one, which is called GLEnable, which means we are enabling something. And I'm just bringing this one a bit more up. Oh, come on here. And we need to tell OpenGL, what do we want to enable? We want to use GL depth test. We want to test if something is before or behind something else in our 3D scene. Right now our two triangles are just there and they are overlapping somewhere, but we're not testing for this. So we need to enable it. And when we enable this, we need to tell OpenGL, how should you compare to overlapping elements. In the real world, that's quite simple. Of course, everything which is closer to you than something else, you just see this. In 3D calculations, you can do other stuff, which does not really go together with what you experience in reality. So we need to tell OpenGL to behave in a way that comes close to reality. And this is the so-called depth function, the function that compares depths of different objects. So GL depth function, and this one needs to get a parameter which tells them how should you work, and we tell them L equal, yes, which means GL less or equal. So everything which has less depth or is equal to another value will be displayed in front. In simple words, when something is closer to me, less depth, closer to me than something else, That's the thing that should be visible. So GL less equal just tells OpenGL how to compare two objects in space and what part of the object should be shown. So first of all, we enable the depth test. We tell OpenGL, I want to use depth information. And we tell them how to compare depth information of different objects. These are two things we just need to do once. So we put them in the init OpenGL function that we created ourselves, which is, just to remind you again, called once on start of our project. So if I've done everything right and the triangles are really overlapping as I expect them, we now should see a difference in the behavior when we render those. Let me check this. But let me just keep this one open for you in case you have not typed it completely while I'm rebuilding and running my application. Yes, basically it seems to work, but I forgot something that we need to implement right now. When we start to use depth information, just like we override the color every frame, we need to override the depth information every frame. Otherwise, OpenGL can't tell, hey, what depth should I start from? So, just like we did here, overwriting the color every frame, we are overwriting the depth information every frame. So GL depth, is it depth bit? I can't recall right now. I'm writing this not so often. Depth buffer bit. This one. So once more, this one by the beginning of every frame tells OpenGL, hey, override everything I've drawn till now with my background color. And the other one tells OpenGL, okay, forget all the depth information that you got from the previous frame. I want to start again from scratch. So we need to call this one as well. So let me check my result here on my side. This looks better indeed. Yes. So, if you take a look at our result right now, you will realize now the triangle in front is overlapping the one in the back. Before it was the other way around. Before indeed the other triangle was in the background. And now we are fine. And now we can really play with the values to see, to bring them to a point where they really overlap completely. So we see, let's say, cutting edges between them. This again is just manipulating the values, because basically our setup should be fine right now. And this is the depth information, so this is happening on the ZX. So I guess we really just need to change the ZX values probably to see the triangles overlapping. So for example, if we take the first triangle and we change its blue corner point, which is the second one, to a ZX with a high value, which means it's, with a small value, sorry, which means it's close to us, close to the camera indeed, then we should have some overlapping effect. Let me try this one. So here I am with the second triangle. And here is the second point, the blue one. And I want to give it a Z value of minus 0.9. Let's see if this works like I expected to. Recompiling and running it. Yes. So, although it's not perfect, I've done something strange there. You see, at some point, they are really overlapping. I should really bring back the triangle, the second triangle, to the middle of the screen, so we can even watch this better. Let me just do this by removing this translation here. Not being so much moved, let's say like this. And let me just rebuild. So I'm just playing around with the figures now. I want to, again, move back the second triangle somewhere into the middle of the screen. And I changed an X, a Z value of one corner point to not have the triangle plane to us, but somehow to be more getting close to us. Oh, and I still have the rotation in it, so it's rotated anyway. So this is even manipulating my final result. But let's just see if we can have a better visual effect of what's going on there. Still not perfect. Let me change this rotation value here to a smaller value. Yeah, you're realizing we're doing a workshop here. This is why I'm live coding and why I'm playing around. I don't have the perfect values for this one in mind. I'm sorry. That's better. So, I hope you can see it on your screen as well, that sometimes now the one triangle is overlapping the others. That's because they are somehow now, the one is a bit strange in space and the other one is rotating through it. But this just shows you that we now really use the depth information of the 3D objects to really make them overlap at some points. And this only works after we have now enabled the so-called depth test, which means we tell OpenGL to compare depth information of objects. And after we told him everything which is closer to the camera, closer to us, should be visible, and things which are in the background should not be visible at all. Maybe I should change the rotation speed of the triangle in the back just to see better the overlapping effect. So I'm just reducing this value. And let me get this one running again. Hopefully we will be able to see it better now. Let's see. So it's coming from the other side again. Here's some overlapping going on. And now as it's rotating into the depths, we've got some other overlapping going on there as well. So that's very important. A 3D scene without depth information won't work. It will work technically, but the result, the visual result, will be something that is not valid compared to the real world. Because this is always, when we're doing 3D scenes, the only thing that we can rely on is that people have an idea how the real world behaves. And we need to make the 3D scene behave like the real world. Of course, a machine can't reproduce reality, so we're just getting close to it. And this is what we're doing by implementing, for example, the depth information here. Okay, so I just leave you again alone with this one for another few seconds, or we should just go on our second break. And after this one, we just have a few more points to go. And but I guess each of us could take a 5-minute break and then we are back. So 5 minutes and we go on. Thank you. Okay, so here we are again, and before we can go on with some other stuff, we just need to bring in a bit more knowledge about how this 3D world behind the monitor, how this imaginary 3D world is working. And this is why I came up with this simple image here. I just grabbed it from Google Image Search as well. Let's just think we've got some kind of camera somewhere, because whenever we think of a 3D scene, a part of the world we are seeing, we need to think of something from where this view is created. This may be a camera, this may be just our eyes, whatever it is, but we need a point from where on we are watching. And we humans are watching the world in so-called perspective mode, which means things which are far away appear smaller than things which are close to us. And till now we haven't used such a mode. We have used and drawn in a so-called orthogonal way, which means we are seeing everything in a very rectangle way. But this is not reality. We want to come closer to reality, and for this we need a so-called perspective projection. We need to see the world through a perspective view. And when we work with this perspective view in OpenGL, there are a few information we need to know. First of all, we need to know the opening angle of our lens. So how far is the angle with which we are looking into this world? For us humans, it's something coming close to 60 degrees, I guess. And so we will use this figure as well. And additionally, we need the information from where to how far can we see in this world. Because this is something that you can't do in 3D worlds. You can't have an infinite view into space, because this is all based on mathematics, and you can't calculate with infinite numbers in mathematics. This just won't work. So what we need to define now, we need to define where is our camera positioned, how is it looking into the world, with what opening angle, where is the closest point to the camera where we start seeing objects, and how far are we looking into the scene. And these are the so-called near clipping plane. This is the closest thing to you that you can see, and the so-called far clipping plane, which means everything beyond this point is cut because it's too far away from us. So we need to define this stuff. So let's get back into the code. So in our code, we need to define this perspective every time that the window size changes, because it's important for this perspective to know the difference or the ratio between the width and the height. So we will do this in our reshape function. This is what it's for. First of all, we just did the GL viewport in our reshape function so far, which is setting once more the part of the window which we are drawing in. And again, this is from lower left side to upper right side. And now we need to tell him, okay, we want to create a perspective. To do this, we need to first of all use a different matrix from OpenGL to handle this perspective information of the scene for us. So we need to tell OpenGL that we want to change the matrix mode. We want to use a different matrix. Till now we always draw on the matrix for our models, for our triangles. But now we want to change a matrix, to modify a matrix, which is responsible for the perspective of the world. So we need to tell OpenGL first of all, hey, let's switch to a different matrix. And this one is called GL projection, as it is doing the perspective projection of the scene. So we are just switching to a different matrix stack, let's say. OpenGL will now be able to save the matrix that we're going to create now in a different stack. And I'm sorry about the mathematics stuff, but there's no 3D rendering without a minimum of mathematics. Okay, now that we've activated this other matrix stack, we need to make sure whatever matrix is in it right now, it needs to be set back to basic. It needs to be set back to identity. So again, we call this function that we already know, gl load identity, just to make sure whatever projection matrix we have till now, whatever camera view we have till now, it's set back to identity. And now comes the really important function, which is creating this 3D scene. And this one again is a glue function from the free GLUT library. And this is called glue perspective. And this now is taking a few parameters as value. The first parameter is really how is the view angle into our world. And I just told you that's, let's say, something like 60 degrees comes close to human eyes. So we put 60 degrees there. The second parameter is very important. We need to know the relation between the width and the height of the window, because when we scale our window, we want our scene to scale accordingly. So OpenGL needs to know how big in width and height is your window, and what is the relation between it, the aspect ratio, as it is called. To do so, we need to divide the width by the height. That's quite simple. But as these are integer values, we just need to make them float values. So we cast them. Not quite sure. Whatever language you are using normally, this shouldn't be too different in all the languages. So now we know the viewing angle and we know the relation between width and height. And what we need to know now, or what OpenGL needs to know now, how close to the camera should it start displaying objects and how far should it go away? So we tell him, I want to start by 1.0 and I want to go for another 10 units. And this is something where we need to talk about. These are so-called OpenGL units. OpenGL units don't have any relation to units that you know from the real world. So these are not inches, not floats, not meters, not centimeters, nor miles. This is just what you make out of it. So an OpenGL unit is whatever you want it to be. So if you decide in your 3D program one OpenGL unit is 1 centimeter, or is 1 millimeter, or is 1 inch, then it will be this one, because you are doing all the equations according to the metric system that you apply. So this just means in our scene, for example, if I say, okay, everything in my scene is done in inches, this would mean starting from the first inch, 1 inch away from the camera, going on 10 to 10 inches away from the camera, which means between we've got 9 inches of visible space. This is what these values are. So once more, this one is creating the matrix which describes our 3D visible space, which is also called the frustum in OpenGL. And for this we need the viewing angle, we need the aspect ratio between width and height, and we need to know what part of the scene the camera can see. Now let me get you back this image to hopefully increase your understanding. So, the viewing angle is really the lens somehow of the camera. The aspect ratio, of course, is to know the ratio between the width and the height. And then you've got this 0.1 value, which means it's this near clipping plane, this first value, and the 10 means it's a far clipping plane. And everything in this section here, in this area, will be visible. This will be really occur on the screen. Everything else outside this portion will not be visible. It will be there in 3D space, but it will not get visible to us because it's outside the calculated area that we want to show from our 3D world. So this creates this perspective view. And after we've done this, we need to make sure, okay, we just turn to this matrix mode for the projection, for the perspective projection, but now we want to get back to another matrix mode to be able to move our triangles separately from this projection mode. I admit this is a bit tricky, but first of all, just take it as it is and try to understand it later the more you play around with it, the better you will understand what's going on there. So we will turn the matrix mode back to GL model view, if I'm right. Yes, model view, which makes sure that now we are manipulating matrices which are on a different stack. Not on the projection stack, but on the different stack. Just think of it at this way. We just activated some kind of stack. We just put a matrix into it, and we don't want to change it. So we need to turn back to another stack again. This is what we're doing here. Okay, so now we've turned to the model view stack again. So we need to come up with the changes for our models now. So this is what our triangles are actually doing. So let's get back to our triangles. And remember, our world now is starting at 1 and is reaching from 1 to 10 means 9 units of view, which means everything which has a value lower than 1 on the ZX, on the depth information, will not be visible. So we need to bring our triangles into this visible space. So going back to the display function, and all we need to check here is the Z coordinate of our triangles, because this one right now is on 0, and 0 is not between 1 and 10, so it's outside the visible area. So let's keep it simple and let's make this one 5 for all the for the vertex information. The color is not the vertex information. So let's make this one 5, because as soon as we've got this perspective projection, we are leaving this default space of -1, +1, -1, +1, because now we can act and move objects in this 3D world defined by this perspective projection from 1 to 10. So let's change the vertex information of the Z values. Let's change them all to 5, so the triangles are pretty far in the middle of our 3D scene. And I do this for the first triangle, just like I do it for the second triangle as well. Maybe I leave this value a bit different here. Oh no, first of all, I just change them all to 5. So all our vertex information of all the triangles should now have a Z value of 5 to make sure they are somehow inside our 3D space and inside our 3D visible space. And after we've changed those, and if I have not done too many errors, our scene should look a bit different. Let me try. And I don't see anything. That's great. So let's check for errors. Okay, let me just check my reshape function once more. We're setting the viewport, we are going to projection mode, we are loading an identity, we are going to create a perspective, width and the height, model view is fine as well. And in the render function, we are going to clear all the information to load an identity. And now we are in the model view matrix stack. We are translating and rotating the stuff. And we have moved all the vertices to a proper point. Okay, basically this looks fine for me, but it seems I've got a small bug in it. So that's just another 1 minute break for you, for me to bug fix this one, and I'll come back to you in a few seconds as soon as I realize what's my bug here. Here we are again, and I need to really be ashamed of this one, because whenever I'm doing an OpenGL training, during the first half of an hour into the training, I tell the people this is the major error that people do over and over again, and this is why they also get so desperate of not seeing anything. They're doing everything right and they do not see anything on the screen, and I just did this error and it's such a shame, I'm sorry. But I want to explain it to you, because this may have happened to you as well, and it will happen to you in the future, as I have just proven. So what has happened? In default OpenGL setting, when we created a perspective, it's assumed that the camera is positioned at 000 in this 3D space and is watching along the negative ZX. So we are watching towards negative minus 10, minus 100 on the ZX. And I just changed the triangles to have a positive Z value. So what happened? The triangles were just in the back of us. And just like in reality, everything which is in the back of us, we can't see it. So I just changed the Z values of the triangles to negative values. And this just showed them up on the screen. This is what we needed, and now they are really in front of us, in front of our perspective view. So I just deactivated the movement to find the arrow, so I will bring in the movement again, and we just watch our triangle spin around in space with this perspective view. So let me just come up with the movement again. And let the triangles fly around again. Ah, come on, where is it? I just saw it moving, it's moving so slow. There it is again. So, what you can see right now, as we've got a perspective now. First of all, I'm looking down the negative ZX, which means it's now moving the other way around. It's moving from right to the left. And it's also moving in some kind of rotation around us. Oh, and this is one of the major errors as well that I always tell in my sessions. Shame on me. Today I'm really doing all the errors that I try to warn people about. But I will just tell you what is the problem here. As you see now, the triangle is no longer rotating on its own, but it's somehow in an orbit around us. It's flying around us. That's because I've done the translation and rotation in the wrong order. So when you do it like I've done it here, when you translate something first and then you rotate it, it will get into a orbital way around you, but it needs to be the other way around. Let me correct this one to show you the difference. Just keep in mind, now it's spinning around us, and I'm just changing the order of these two function calls. First I rotate and then I translate. Just remember, these are mathematics equations going on in a 4x4 matrix, which describes the final position of a point in space. So it makes a difference if you first rotate or translate, because on matrix operations, it makes a difference how you multiply. So let me just compile and run this one for you. And still I seem to have a bug in it, because it's still rotating around us. It's bug day today, I'm sorry for this one. Let me just check. Okay, we've got the rotation and translation on this one. We've got a load identity. This one is not rotating at all, that's all perfectly fine. So let me kick out the translation here. I just want to get close to the problem. But that's the point when we're doing live coding. It's still rotating. I'm sorry, give me another 1 minute break to fix this bug and I'll come back to you. Okay, I just checked the calendar and it says today is the day of stupid errors. It must be right. I'm sorry. That's really ridiculous, but that's the point of live coding and live workshops. So it's correct. The behavior so far is correct because I want to explain this one to you as well. It's good that I'm doing this errors. This may keep you from doing this errors later as well. I've changed the coordinates of our triangle. I moved it away from the midpoint. I moved it away from 0, 0, 0 by minus 1, which means the triangle is no longer located at the origin of our coordinate system, which means when I've got the coordinate system and this is my midpoint and I move the triangle here, as soon as I start to rotate my coordinate system, the triangle rotates around the midpoint instead of what I want to achieve, having it in the midpoint and rotating the triangle itself. So this was my mistake here. Let's just bring back the vertices to zero values, at least on the ZX, as well for the other triangle as well. And now you may say, okay, they're at 0, 0, 0 again. How can we see them? They are outside the visible area. And you're right. And this is what we're going to use the translate for. Because we can move the triangles away from us. So let's translate this triangle away from us by 4 units. And as we are moving the negative ZX, it must be minus 4, I'm sorry. And the other triangle as well. I just commented out the translate and rotate for debugging. Let's move this one away from us as well by minus 4. And hopefully, I have not tested this right now, but hopefully this one is working fine now. Both triangles should be in front of us, visible, and the first one should be spinning. Let's give it a try. Yes. This is the actual behavior. Now you can tell us, hey, we had this behavior before. You may be right, but we did not have a perspective before. And now you may see, when you look very closely, that this triangle here looks a bit rotated as well, like this. And this is from the perspective view, as it's rotated in itself. This is what we actually wanted to achieve. So now, just to sum it up again, what have I changed? What was my mistake? Once more, the vertices should stay very close to zero. And that's a general rule. Whenever you bring in 3D models to your scene, keep the vertices, the basic vertex information, somewhere around 0, 0, 0. So the object should be placed somehow in the midpoint of your coordinate system, because this enables you to move the object into space and rotate it into space, just like you want to have it. If it's not close to zero, you will just have the effect that we had here. It's spinning somehow around you, although you don't want to have this effect. So let's get now let's get back to the real topics. I'm sorry. I just told you that there is a difference if you rotate or translate something first, and now I need to prove it. Right now, if I just run it again, you see our triangle is probably spinning around it and it's just moving along the X because I tell him to. Now let me change the order of translate and rotate, and you will see that the triangle will start spinning around us, just like in an orbit. So by just changing these two lines, we should have a totally different behavior. And this is what we expect. Yes, it's spinning a bit slow. Let's give him some time. There it is again. So now it's really moving around us because we just changed the fact that we first of all rotated our 3D matrix and then we started to translate it. Both effects could be fine, whatever you want to do. If you want to build a solar system, you're fine just doing it like this. But the usual way is actually, first of all, doing the translation. So first of all, move your object to a point in space along the axis, and when it's there, you start to rotate it. This is what you actually want to achieve. So the correct order, keep this in mind, and keep it in mind better than I did. The correct order is something like this. So once more, every time we draw the frame, we load the identity matrix, which means we reset everything. Then we translate this matrix to a point in space. Then we rotate it at this point in space. And once we've got this matrix, which describes this translation and rotation, we can start to actually draw our 3D information point by point. And what we do here as well, before we draw a point, we tell what color this point should have. Remember, this is the state machine functionality. You set a color, and as long as you don't change it, it stays like this. Okay, so you should have a result like this from the current workshop when it's running on your machine. So having two triangles separately and they are flying through space, at least one of them is spinning around. And this is, I get a guess, a good result for this first workshop today. So just some additional information for you as well. This was just the really low level workshop to the OpenGL beginners workshop. Tomorrow in the afternoon at 6 o'clock PM German time, that's I guess 5 o'clock PM Central time, we will go on with another workshop where we will assume that you have this basic knowledge of OpenGL that we did today. So if you want to join tomorrow, you're welcome to join as well, because tomorrow we will do even more. We will change the way that we draw elements and the way that we manage our 3D data in a different way. We will put them into arrays, and this is a usual modern way, because what we've learned today is a very basic approach with a so-called OpenGL